Thank you very much. I don't understand any Swedish. You could have been saying anything at all, but thank you very much. Well, welcome back, and how fabulous that you're moving forwards, little bit at a time. Now you're all in the middle, which is great. There's a few, somebody die hard at the back, that's fine. But it's lovely. It really helps me, actually, to feel I can know you a bit better. I hope you found that interesting, the first bit. What I'm going to do in the second, in this part now, is I'm going to take things really, really back to basics. Is there anyone in the room who has, I tell you what, I'll start at the other end. Who in here has been using solution focus for more than 10 years? If you put your hand up. Okay, so a few of you. More than 5 years. Okay. More than 1 year. Okay. And never done it before, never doesn't really know, you've heard your colleagues talking about it. Great, okay, so a few, so that's really good. Hopefully all of you will find something useful. So I'm really gonna take things right back to the beginning here. I've never worn one of these before. It's quite fun. Can you all hear me? Yeah, it's like I feel like I'm my fantasy of being Madonna, or so I start singing. No, I won't, because seriously, I can't sing, but it's quite exciting. It's quite an exciting experience. You should try it, really. You do these things. You see, this is like the solution focus thing, is that when you take small steps, your whole world changes. You know, when I saw that this, I walked in the room and it's like, I'm going to have to wear one of these. And again, my heartbeat was like, I was so nervous, thinking, my goodness, it's going to... And then you do it, and then you think, actually, I could get used to this. This is quite good. I love this quote. I saw it at a solution-focused conference once. I don't know, do you know the Little Prince, the book? Yeah, by Antoine de Saint-Exupéry. It's probably my favorite. It was my favorite book as a child. There's a bit inside it, those of you who may have read it, where as a boy, he draws a picture of an elephant inside a boa constrictor. I don't know if you've ever seen this. So you've got like the thin bit of the snake, the boa, and then the big bit with the elephant inside, and then the tail. And he shows it to grown-ups, and he says, "What's this?" And many, many of the grown-ups say, "It's a hat." And he's very disappointed that they can't see that it's a snake with an elephant inside it that's been swallowed by one of these boa constrictors. And then every now and then he meets a grown-up who says, "Oh, that's an elephant inside a boa constrictor." And he's really happy. And then he thinks as a child, and he thinks, wow, is that what happens when you become a grown-up? You forget. Something so wonderful as a boa, that a boa constrictor can eat an elephant. I don't think they can, but, you know, an elephant inside a boa constrictor. And he says something in this book, which is that all grown-ups were children once, although most of them have forgotten it. I love that. Because for me, one of the liberating things for me when I became, you know, kind of interested in solution focus was it just stopped me from having to be the expert and to know everything. And that kind of open mind, Urban put that beautiful quote up from Frank Zappa, you know, minds are like parachutes, they only work if they're open. So I love this quote. In the solution focus world, people are really interested in quotes that make you kind of think a bit differently. I love this one. Because for me, it is that thing about, it's not about setting goals. It's about, of course, you must set goals. I mean, I know I was being provocative earlier, but it's good to have, you know, ideas of where you want to be in the future. I don't want to put you off by thinking, oh, I can't be solution focused because I have to set goals. Of course you do. But it's this idea that if you want to build a ship, don't drum up. That means to kind of encourage people. Come, 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 come. Lots of men. Go and gather the word. Go, you do this, you do this, you do this, you do this. You can do that, obviously. Organization and goals are important. But actually, instead, teach them to yearn for the vast and endless sea. And that's what I think we do in Solution Focus. We teach people, we help people who have perhaps given up longing, given up wanting something. They've given up their dreams. They don't see past their difficulties. I'm sure many of you have worked with people who, for life has been so difficult that you just give up any willingness to long for something. We meet people who, as children, had that stamped out of them, which is really a sad place to be. And I think when you're working with people who've been in that situation, if you start with kind of getting them to think ahead, it's really hard because they're out of practice. They've kind of given that up. A lot of people, if you sort of go straight into kind of thinking about the future in terms of something quite concrete, they feel they've tried everything already. I've tried that. So I think we're doing something different here. I think we're working on a different level with people. There's another one, actually, Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, which you can find as well, which is that most people see a pile of rocks, but an architect sees a cathedral. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get you to think about the underlying principles of solution focus. I want you to learn some skills for practicing solution focus, and we're going to look at what the whole process is as a whole. For those of you who maybe have not come across it before, just to give you a little bit of background, I've got to remember my long glasses tomorrow. So basically, the solution-focused approach, it came out of people who were working in systemic and family therapies. So it didn't grow out of a kind of that kind of psychodynamic individual internalized version of therapy work. It's more about an interactive view of people interacting with their environment and with other people. It started out by a group of researchers watching tapes of people having conversations. And Steve DeShazer had a research question, and his research question was, what's happening when people start to actually change? When actually people start to really talk about making change? And he and his colleagues recorded what was happening. And then they decided to run an experiment. And the experiment was, what happens if we just ask those questions? That's a bit of a potted history, to be honest. But but in essence, that's kind of what they started doing. And then they set up their own practice. Lots of people came in and out, worked with them to develop the practice. Because it arose from this particular kind of ground of therapy, it's quite influenced by these kind of systemic ideas and ideas about change. Thinking about how change you can do things that are different, that seem different, but that doesn't change the system. Kind of what you might call a first order change. I always think of it like when I work, when my children were small, and you would try and get your children to change their behavior. And you could maybe, speak sternly to them, or you could, shout, or you could take something away from them, or, you know, variations of things, but actually never changed anything. It just kind of, it just upped the intervention, and then their behavior had to get worse before they reached the point at which you were going to put the punishment or the sanction in. That's kind of a sort of first order change. Whereas what you might call a second order change would be something where you actually do something, you actually take a completely different tactic or strategy and everything shifts and then you get a different kind of change. So I might have sat down and said to my children something like, they come in and they're, you know, quite often they come in and they're angry or they're very full of their emotions. I remember one of my daughters in particular, she's one of these people, she's still like this, she's 22 years old now, she's still like this. I want the entire world now, everything in it, now, I want it all now. And so she would run into the room and she'd go at me. And I would sort of stand there and I would say to her, okay, there's something you're trying to tell me, which is obviously very important to you, but the way that you're telling it to me, I can't understand it. So why don't you pop outside the door and have a think? Think about a better way of talking to me so that I can hear you, and then come back, try again. And she would go, okay. She'd go away. Mummy, I would like to... She really, honestly, it really works. I like to give as many parenting tips as possible when I'm training. It's the area that really helped me the most, actually, with solution focus. So this idea that change happens, you know, this sort of technologies of change, if you like, they all kind of influence. So this idea that you're disrupting patterns and so on. So there was quite a lot of technical talk about it all going on. And then as you maybe know, is that Steve DeShazer was really philosophical. He thought a lot about different things, and he was very influenced by different thinkers of the time. And particularly, he was fascinated by the work of Milton Erickson. Milton Erickson was a unique therapist, really, who, I don't know, invented a form of hypnotherapy, I guess they might call it. He had polio when he was a child, and he was paralyzed, so he had a lot of time to think without actually, you know, being able to move. And he developed a very unique ways of working with people that maybe kind of sparked a change. And people watched his tapes avidly, trying to work out what he did because he had such remarkable results. And Steve DeShazer watched a lot of those. And so there's this kind of element where when people talk about solution focus, they quite often draw on ideas of kind of like hypnotic or that you're creating like a trance with people. And again, maybe that's true. I think these are very useful and interesting ways of thinking about solution focus. So it's just, I just want to kind of give you a flavor, because if you start, those of you particularly who have, maybe it's new to you or you, I'm going to take my glasses off because I can't actually see you now, who maybe haven't done it at all. If you start to go and read the literature, there's a very wide range of books available, and some of them have got a lot of make a lot of reference to these kinds of ideas, and some of them are very practical. I tend to be on the practical side, but I think it's really worth having an exploring over there where these kinds of really interesting thinkers are, because it helps you to understand, I think, how it's grown. Wittgenstein, I'm not going to have to say anything about Wittgenstein because you've got a session tomorrow, I believe, with Patrick, who is going to tell you all about how Wittgenstein can be of a useful philosophy to think about when you're working in a solution-focused way. But just to say, the thing that I think for me, Wittgenstein, the philosopher, that this is the idea that things happen in language. And that actually, our reality is language based, and that actually we're engaging all the time in games around language when we have communication, when we talk. There are set games that we understand and we play, and we can, by changing those games a little bit, we can create difference. So these are different ways of thinking about what might be happening in solution focus, because what you won't find in solution focus is a theory of the person. Which is what you get in most other therapeutic approaches. Okay. So there are some core assumptions which you kind of operate from if you're working from a solution-focused frame. And these are not, these are not the facts of solution focus. Lots of people do this. Lots of people think, what is going on underneath it? These are the ones that, for me, I find the most useful, maybe the most ones that where I see a similarity between all the other people who are thinking about solution focus. So basically, finding out the cause of the problem is not necessarily a step towards its resolution. I talked a bit about that in the earlier session. It is quite a radical move in therapy, because actually a lot of therapy is based on finding the root cause of a problem. It's more helpful to consider the history of the solution than the history of the problem. And I like that. I got that from Michael Hyatt. It's a really nice idea, because when you're having a problem-focused conversation, you're going along a path, aren't you? You know, so when did it start, you know, and then what happened, and what happened next, and how did that affect you? You know, and you're walking along this path, and then you want to walk towards solutions, and you have to turn around and walk towards solutions. But because you're on a trajectory, you're the movement is this way, it's kind of hard, isn't it, to make that turn. And you find your clients, you know, you're over here dragging them across to the solution bit, and they're still walking over here. So it's that kind of momentum. So if you start with the solution, okay, so is there a time in your past when you were able to cope with a situation like this? Tell me a bit more about, you know, the kind of support networks that you've had at your disposal, and tell me a bit more about where you're hoping to end up. You're actually taking people on they don't have to move, they're on that trajectory. Does that make sense? So there's kind of this idea, there's a movement in conversations that you're having. When people are coming to you with problems, they often, I'm quite sure, they feel stuck. They feel that they've tried everything, nothing's changing. And so people have experienced their distress, maybe depression, it's got a name, it's like a thing that sits on you. They experience it as something static. And that's, again, I think part of what we do is we take, because of that's categorizing thing, isn't it? I've had a bad day. Well, maybe something good happened in that day. It's always the same, for example. So in solution focus, we think, I don't believe that. I don't believe that it's the same all the time, actually. And I'm going to find out where those little things that are different are, and I'm going to help you to think about them and notice them. We make the assumption that people have resources. Again, I think most of us who work with people in any place, we have to think like that. We can't believe that if you don't believe that someone has the capacity to change and the resources to change, you really can't do your job. Unless your job is to protect and to care for people who are really vulnerable and who aren't going to change. That is sometimes the case. I'm not saying that's not the case. But we can maybe think that even if someone, the person, might not be able to change, their situation could improve. There's always the environment that we can work from as well. And that, and this for me is like the power, the secret power of solution focus is that small steps can facilitate great changes. So we are always thinking about, you know, what's that movement, that sense of what's the next thing that we can do, however small, because quite often those small steps can lead to very, very big changes. So I think when you're thinking about what's happening when you're being solution focused, and this is what hopefully you'll start to experience through what I'm going to ask you to have a go at, is that you're creating an expectation of change. When you work with people, you're creating that expectation because you're using language. You're using the language of change. You're beginning to generate hope. And you do that because you're getting people to really think about future in a really, really beautifully rich detail. But not just that, because that's like, you know, do you have that here in Sweden? Are people interested in the law of attraction? Yeah? The law of attraction where you imagine your future and it comes towards you. I mean, I don't know. I mean, the universe is a mysterious place, and to be honest, really strange things happen much more than we understand. But I think that actually what's really going on is that you start to take action differently when you start to think differently about the future. It's the action that generates the forward movement and generates change and generates things apparently moving towards you. You see the world differently. There's a researcher called Oettinger who looked at change from this perspective of techniques that visualize the future, techniques that set goals, that create changes, and so on. Lots of different ways of thinking about it. And what she found out was that the best types of change happen when you have a picture of the future, but also you're realistic about where you are right now. And I think, actually, the solution focus is perfectly designed to do that. You are conveying confidence in people's ability by focusing on their strengths, by focusing on their resources and helping them to identify them. You're collaborating on solution building, and we're going to look a little bit about that. What is that? You're exploring their possible small steps. And I think it celebrates success. You're deliberately focusing on improvement, however small. So I think that's kind of what's happening when you're being solution-focused. And one of the things that I'm very interested in is making a really, really strong distinction between solution-focus and problem-focus. I have no problem with problem solving. I think problem solving is great. I use it all the time. I used it as an occupational therapist when I was training. If I came into somebody's house and I had someone who couldn't get on and off a toilet, I didn't ask them what their goal was or, you know, where they'd like to end up. I pretty much guessed that they want to be able to use the toilet by themselves. That's what we do a lot of in occupational therapy. So that's a problem. You know, we have different ways to help people on and off the toilet. You provide that. That's a good solution. Problem focus is we're going to find out, and we're going to explore this through the different ways of thinking about it. If we're finding out how much, you know, what all the different component parts of the problem, you're trying to find out what's wrong. And you want to fix that. And actually, most of the training in medical and social care quite often is based on that model, on that individual model. Although there's a big shift happening. I mean, it is shifting. But essentially, a lot of therapies and a lot of ways of working with people are problem focused. So. In terms of the difference between problem focus and problem solving and solution building, problem solving is based on, you know, this idea of the ideal. So what you're trying to do is you have three options in a kind of traditional problem solving frame. You have to find something that's wrong and fix it. You have to mend something that's broken, for example. If you think about it like a broken leg, your bone's broken, you want to fix it, you put a splint or whatever, put it in a plaster to help the bones mend, you fix it. That's a fixing it activity. Maybe you want to add something to correct what's a deficiency, something that's not there. If you think about medicine, medicine is an adding something. People take insulin because they don't produce their own if they have diabetes, for example. You might put a pacemaker inside, open up your body, put a pacemaker into the heart to help it beat properly. It's an addition. Or you might take away something that's causing somebody difficulty. So, like, maybe my appendix is infected, so take it out. All of that works really well. Personally, my life has been saved 3 times by this kind of medicine, problem-solving-based medicine. It's really, really effective. I have no argument with it at all. If we take it into the therapy world, if you think about CBT, it's very powerful therapy. You are maybe thinking about that people have faulty thoughts or faulty ways of constructing their world. They have like black and white thinking or catastrophizing. So we identify something that's not working and you fix it by, you know, creating a different way of thinking. These are really powerful tools. Maybe taking away intrusive thoughts or unhelpful thought patterns and so on. Those are all kind of problem-solving approaches to working with people. Very, very powerful. On the other hand, this is the problem, I think, with quite a lot of what we end up working with. If we think about people like washing machines, then it's easy to think about problem-solving. Because the washing machine is like one of those mechanical things that has an ideal way to be, to function, and then we can find out what's wrong and we can fix it. So maybe, you know, something's got stuck. I had a coin in the pocket, it's got stuck, we have to take it out. Or something's gone wrong, we have to fix it, or we have to put a new part in, take an old one out, put a new part in. And I think that we encounter difficulties if we treat human beings like washing machines, because actually I think we are more like the picture on the right. We're very complex, our situations are very complex. They're really actually messy situations. And one of the interesting things about solution focus is that it's very, very, very simple. There's an awful lot of us going around doing trainings in solution focus when it's about, you know, 3 things, really. That's what makes it kind of tricky, because actually in our minds, we sort of can't believe that it can be that easy. So what happens quite often is initially you think, well, I'll try solution focus out on someone with a very easy problem. And actually what you end up doing is doing over-specified, you know, it's too much for a problem. Actually, solution focus works really well when things are complex. It's actually a very good way of working with people, because it doesn't require you to have a kind of mechanics mind. So in solution focus, we're doing something quite different. So we're thinking about what is the preferred future. If the person stays on the trajectory, where are they going to end up? They probably don't want to be there. That's why they're feeling distressed. They want to be somewhere better. So we're thinking, well, okay, what's that other place? Where does that other place you want to end up? And then we're thinking about, well, is any of that happening now? Or, you know, what might be the building blocks that we could use to start moving towards that direction instead of this direction? And then we spend time exploring, you know, what are the possible things we can do right now, and then maybe just agree on the small step that people are going to take. So it's quite a different process. So what you're focusing on is the difference someone wants to see in their life, you know, their preferred future. Now, I talked about that a bit more earlier, I think that's one of the most powerful questions that you can ask people, which is, what difference will that make? We make a deliberate focus on what's working well right now. And we actively go about finding strengths and resources in the person and in their wider context. That's an activity. That's an active thing that we do. We actually spend time there. And we work out the small steps that will bring some changes towards the future that people want to go towards. So I think one of the things about solution focus is that if you have been working in a problem-solving way for a long time and you live in the human world, which is full of problem-solving, that's what's talked about all the time, or much of the time, we are incredibly skillful at asking about problems. When friends come to us and tell us the problems they're having with their partner or with their children or whatever, we'll talk a lot about those things. Even though maybe in our work life we're solution focused, but that problem stuff is really with a habit of talking about problems is very strong within us. So I think in order to be solution focused, you really have to start listening differently. You have to actually, it's like tuning in to a different channel on the radio. So these are kind of the skills that I think you have to if you want to get really good at solution focus, these are the things you need to be able to. You need to listen. You have to be listening for strengths and resources all the time. That's your focus of your listening all the time. And you want to be able to actually communicate back. Now, this is controversial. Not everyone believes in feedback in solution focus. I do very strongly believe that it's a really important aspect. I've worked always with people who are in a very, very, very bad situation. I worked with people who had very severe mental health problems, who had those for many, many years. I'll give you an example. I had the type of person who was referred to me was like they'd say, here, we're going to refer this person to you. They are the worst self-harmer in Kent. It's the area of England I live in. The worst self-harmer in Kent. That's a label, isn't it? And I worked with people with chronic pain management. I don't know, does anyone here work with chronic pain? People who have chronic pain or chronic illnesses, they are some of the most stuck and distressed people I've ever worked with. So I've worked with people who have, live in horrible situations and so on. So I think in the luxury of maybe a coaching environment or a some other kind of environment. Where people have maybe a little bit more resourceful, sense of resource. Maybe you don't have to give feedback, but I personally think you do need to. Let people know give them feedback in a way that helps them to hook into their strengths and resources. But I'm going to teach you a very specific way of doing that. And I think you have to be able to avoid getting sucked into long discussions about problems. Anyone interested in that? No? Nobody finds complaining and okay, that's you're allowed to talk to me. It's really lonely up here if people don't speak, actually. You start to doubt yourself and you think, and then also about building how to build solutions using solution focused questions. Okay. So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna get you to talk to each other. And I put my glasses on. Just check something. Yep. Okay. So I want you to talk to someone next to you. This is like the simplest, basic level. And I want you to talk to them about their hobbies and their interests. I don't want you to talk about work. I want you to find out what they enjoy doing and something that they are interested in, that they really love doing. And I want you to focus on asking them, how do you do that? So I want you to find out how they do that. That's the question. Okay? I want you to, and just keep, you know, once you've found out how they do something, I want you to ask, you know, what else? What else do you do? And how do you do that? Really, 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 you know, ask, just keep asking about that. And I want you to listen for their strengths and qualities. What are the things that you can tell about them? What can you pick up about them? And then I'm going to get you, you know, afterwards, I'm going to get you to create some evidence-based compliments. Now, that's what, you know, we keep, what I want you to do is I want you to be able to feed back what you heard about somebody, what their strengths are, what their qualities are, and to be able to provide evidence for it. Okay? So when you spoke about, you know, I think you're really well organized, you know, because the way that you talked about, you know, when you do your jewelry making, you have everything set out, you know, and you know, so on. So I want you to really be able to provide that evidence. You know, I was listening and it really struck me that you are, when I heard you talking about such and such, that you have these qualities. Okay, and I want you to be curious, because this is the number one mindset of solution focus, is to be genuinely curious. So I've got a little circle here. I hope it works. It's a timer. And what's going to happen is it's going to turn red, like a clock. And when it gets to the halfway, you're going to swap over, okay? So you might ask, one person starts asking first, and then when you come to the half, I want you to swap over. Are you willing to do this? Okay, good. Has everyone got someone to talk to? There's an awful lot of single people. Okay, so you need to swap over. If one person has only been talking, give someone the other person a chance. Okay, that's your time. Now, this is the bit now you have to do a little bit more hard work. You know, you need to stay with the person that you've been talking to. And what I want you to do is now I want one turn each, I want you to tell them three things that you picked up about them with evidence. Okay? And when they are telling you these things, you just listen, okay? So one person goes and the other person goes. So just three things, and that you have to be able to evidence them. Three things that you learned about them, about what their strengths and qualities are. So swap over if you haven't done it already. So make sure the other person gets some feedback. Okay, do you need more time? Anyone need more time? Okay. Okay. What are you like in Sweden for taking compliments? Are you like the British? Or are you happy to take nice things? The British hate it. quite often when you live in a culture where people don't like getting compliments, nice things, you develop this ability to sort of go, oh, no. Do you do that? Yeah, it's a bit like that. So I'm interested in the things that you heard about yourself that the person discovered from listening to you. Did you believe them? Yes. Okay. It's really important, this, because was it nice to hear it? Were you surprised? Anybody surprised? Or did you recognize yourself? Yeah, recognize yourself. Did you find it easy to find things to tell people? Yeah, good, good. I think, again, quite often in the solution-focused world, people are coming from a position where they are solution-focused therapists. They have someone come into their room. They sit with them. They have maybe an hour to talk to them and so on. But I don't know. I think you have different ways of working with people. Maybe you're seeing people in their homes. Maybe you're meeting them in an agency where you have a short amount of time with them. And very different types of interactions with people. I think that in the early days of solution focused, people used to talk a lot about something called problem-free talk. So this idea that initially you would have a problem-free talk time, and it's kind of gone out of fashion. You don't see it so much now. I think it's really useful. I really like it, because the one thing I like about solution focus is that when I was working as an occupational therapist, and also when I work with students, I mean, I have students who come in, have difficulties, so I use it with them too, is that it's a bit weird to start talking in using a kind of therapeutic language or a therapeutic questions. And what I really like about solution focus is that you don't always need to do that. You can use conversational questions. You can use it very conversationally to open up questions. So you can use every opportunity, any opportunity, however small, to create change. And I think that feedback sometimes is very powerful for people. I'll tell you a story. I had a client who was he worked in a hospital. He was a porter. You know, he used to take people around from X-ray to the X-ray, back to the ward, and so on. And he was, you know, a very kind and sweet man. And he was tormented with thoughts of paedophilia, of, you know. It's where people abuse small children, sexual abuse of children. Yeah? So he was obsessed with having thoughts that he was going to abuse children. He never had, but he started getting these thoughts. I mean, in Britain, it was in the media for a long time, so intrusive thoughts all the time. And he was referred to me because he had previously in his life, he'd had another time when he'd had intrusive thoughts about something different, and he'd lost his job, then he lost his wife, and then he lost his home. So this was a repeat of this kind of obsessional thoughts, and he was terrified of what was going to happen to him. So he told me he was just telling me about what he was, you know, what was happening to him. And I was just talking to him about other things. Just tell me a bit more about yourself. You know, what do you enjoy doing? You know, trying to move the conversation and everything. And we had this conversation. At the end, what I did was of this conversation, I'd written down loads and loads and loads and loads and loads of things, and I literally read out a list for about 5 minutes of what I heard about him as a person. You know, all the things that he did. He did charity work. He did all sorts of things. He was a really, you know, he had a lot of, and he had never, ever, ever touched a child. He was just afraid somehow, because it was in his mind that he might do it. So I read out this long list, and he just started crying. He was sobbing. And he said, you know, that's the last thing I was expecting you to say to me. I was expecting you to tell me that I was, you know, I had to be locked up. In the end, I did something quite unusual. I actually didn't do solution focus with him. I did absolute CBT, told him exactly what to do, because that just, you know, sometimes you just do. I thought this man just needs structure. And that's what I did. Affirmations, all of his stuff, you know, 4 weeks, all of his thoughts had gone. And he was fine. But so it's not really a great story from a solution focus perspective, but sorry. But I think it was because I had set up this rapport with him, this understanding with him, right from the beginning, through this kind of listening for his strengths and resources, because he believed that I believed in him. And I think it's really powerful. You know, you all have really lots of skills already, by the way. So you probably also know sometimes you do other things that your instinct tells you. I tend to be solution focused until I'm not. But mostly, I say 99% of the time, I'm solution focused, and then suddenly I might veer off. Okay, so we're going to do something a little bit different, because this is the thing I think is quite tricky, is that problems are like whirlpools. They suck you in. You're having a nice solution-focused conversation with someone, and then they start to bring up problems. They bring up problems. Really hard to get out of that whirlpool where people are talking about problems. And people have really horrific things that they tell you. You know, I mean, I don't know. I heard some really, really terrible stories. So being able to again get yourself out of that and not get sucked into listening to people's problems. I have this exercise which I'm going to get you to do. Because when you work with people who complain, do you have clients that complain a lot? Anyone? It's a naughty question, I know. But people they feel the need to complain, because again, you know, if you're living in a world where you think that you're going to get help by understanding everything about the problem, then you try to be very helpful to your practitioner, to your worker, to your therapist, by telling them all about your problem, because that's what you think is going to help. So they're trying to be helpful, basically, to tell you about they want to complain. So two things tend to happen, which is that you kind of you want to get involved with it, or you want to give advice. You get pulled quite quickly into wanting to give advice. Or you want to push people away. It's like, I don't want to listen. It's like, oh, come on. So in solution focus, especially those of you who've never done it before or don't know much about it, what you're trying to do all the time is to learn about the person, so that you're trying to shift them towards something that can help them build a solution. So that involves listening as well, in a very different way. So that was easy, finding out what people are good at. So we're going to do something a bit trickier, which is is that the right word? I use the translate. I think that's a great name. Clog. Is it clogger? Clog? Clogger, clogger, clogger. You're going to complain a lot. I'm going to get you complaining. So this one's going to be more structured. I'm going to do one way, and then I'm going to do the other way. Okay, I've got a timer as well. So you have to choose. Now, there's a couple of you I noticed, like there's a man right at the back. That must have been very boring, watching people talking to each other. And there's a three down here. So I would invite you to join in with this one, because it's more fun. Wave. No, don't want to. That's okay. If you don't want to, that's fine. But I noticed there were other people who were not necessarily in. You can do it in a three if you want. But I'd like, if possible, for you to be involved and actually, because that's how you kind of get the real flavor of what's happening. So if you have to move around a bit, you know, actually get up and move, please feel free to do so. But I want you to be, if possible, in pairs. And one of you is going to be the person who's going to moan. That's the word we use in English, to complain. So when you go on and on and on and on about something. And we all have things that we complain about. I hate it when I go to the supermarket and there's not enough people serving. Everything's self-service now, of course. Also, in England, we have very narrow roads. I don't know if you've any really narrow roads. They only take one car. And then people drive these big 4x4 cars, massive SUVs, and they don't move, because they don't want to get their 4x4 scratched or dirty. You know, a 4x4 which is designed for, you know. So I get really annoyed about that. I've got a Volvo now, so I can be mean. So I like Swedish cars. I want you to do it. I want you to pick something that really annoys you, but not about work, please. I don't want you to moan about work. Okay? Not allowed to moan about work. Just something, doesn't matter how trivial, but just things that really annoy you. You can moan about politics and whatever if you want. I won't understand anyway. But I want you to do it for 3 minutes. So the person who's complaining, you need to do it for 3 minutes and not stop. If you run out, you have to have another one. Okay? I really mean it. Okay, don't start. I need you to be quiet and listen, because the other person who's listening, you have a really important job to do. Okay? You have to listen. And I mean listen, because you are not allowed to talk. Forbidden. The only thing you can do is nod your head. So please do that. And you have to listen and think, what sort of person complains about something like this? Not a bad answer, by the way. Get a life. No, you're not allowed to think that. You have to think, what sort of person would complain about something? So, for example, if someone is complaining about something not being fair, that probably means they have a very strong sense of justice. Yeah? They maybe have a very strong sense of justice. If they complain that things are badly organized, they probably are good at organization, because people who are good at organization get very annoyed with people who are messy and disorganized. So you maybe that this kind of person has so that's what you've got to do. You've got to think, what sort of person, what are their strengths and qualities? It's a bit more difficult than it was before. So I'm going to put the timer on. There's a timer at the bottom here. This is a timer, the bar. And it will become full after 3 minutes. And then you're allowed to stop. And at the end of that 3 minutes, you have to give your compliments. You have to give your feedback based on evidence. It has to be based on what you hear. Okay? Is everyone ready? Has everyone got someone to do this with? I think there's a seven up there. Maybe they need. See with the woman in orange. Okay. Are you? I'm going to start you all at the same time. Okay. So remember, only one person's allowed to complain. The other one must listen, say nothing. You are only thinking about what am I going to tell them that is good about them. Their qualities at the end. That's what you've got to be listening for. Okay, are you ready? I'm going to put the timer on. Keep going, you're only halfway through. Keep complaining. And it's still more time. Come on, keep going. Don't give up. Okay, that's it. Okay. Right. Okay, right. Now you need to give them their feedback. What did you find? What did you find out? What are their strengths and strengths and qualities? So, by the way, when you're listening to what the person has to say, you're not allowed to say anything. You just listen, okay? So let them tell you. I'll give you a minute or something to do that. Okay, so we're going to do it the other way because I want you both to have, this experience, one of receiving the feedback, but also of listening like this, intensely listening for what people are like. So I'm going to put the timer on again, and we're going to swap over now. Okay, go. So keep going, keep going. Keep going, keep going. Don't give up yet, keep complaining. You're nearly there, but keep going. Keep complaining. Okay, you can stop. Phew, well done. Okay. So, now I want you to do what your partner did for you. I want you to give them the feedback. What did you learn about their strengths and qualities? And when you are listening, please just listen, don't interrupt, and just allow yourself to hear what people are saying to you. Okay, so I'll give you a minute or so to do that. Okay, so you can always carry on later. I hate telling people to stop when they're saying nice things to each other. And usually it's impossible. Okay, so have you... did you believe the things that were said? Did you believe them? The things that people said to you? Yeah? And were you surprised? Anyone surprised? Yeah? Some people were surprised. Good. Yeah, surprised. That's good. So you learn new things about yourself that you maybe hadn't thought about, maybe? Yeah. Okay. And were you surprised at what you found yourself telling people that you were able to find those things? I always do this exercise. I invented it many, many years ago, and I always do it because I think for me one of the things about solution focus was it completely changed my feelings towards my service users, my clients. Before I did solution focus, I would see in the morning a list of people that I had to see, and there was always one or two people on that list that I just thought, oh God. You don't have people like that, do you? But yeah, and it did really make things a bit different. I'm going to do another exercise in a minute where you're gonna have a real chance to talk about those people. I used to find it really hard when people used to come in and complain and so on, and you know, and I just felt so helpless because I couldn't solve their problems. You know, their problems were so complex, their situations. I felt depressed about it. One of the lovely things about solution focus is you start to be able to find the gold, you know, the gold nuggets or the diamonds in that mess, and also to take a little bit of that responsibility that you have, and put it over there. And this is, I think, a process of empowering people to take that job on, because in solution focus you're getting people to take responsibility for their own lives and take their own steps. And that's a big, big deal. I don't know if any of you find change easy. I certainly don't. I find change quite hard. It's a big job if you haven't been doing it for a while. So I think that thing of strengthening people is really important. It's a couple of things to notice. When you were complaining to them, did you feel listened to? Did you feel that they were listening to you? You actually feel that. That's interesting, isn't it? Because a lot of the time when we complain to people, we don't feel listened to because they're doing that thing that they're taught in customer service school, where they're taught to keep very quiet and just wait till someone shuts up. So you know that nobody's listening to you. They're just waiting. And then the other thing is, did any of you feel, not that you would ever do that, obviously, but you get that impulse to do that, don't you? You're listening, oh, yeah, and you're just not there. The other impulse, which is to, did anyone want to give advice, solve the problem? Did you feel that? Did you feel that urge at all? Anyone? Yeah, a few of you, you feel that urge. It's very powerful, that way that the power of the problem sucks you in. Right, now you're going to get to really complain. Okay. You've got 4 minutes. I'm going to give you 2 minutes each. So again, when you see the circle go down to the half, it's time to swap over. I want you to complain about your most difficult client. You all have somebody you work with, and the one who you find most difficult. So I want you just to describe them. I don't want you to complain about them. You can just describe them and describe, you know, what's going on. Why are they your most difficult client? Okay, so I'm going to put the timer on. And it doesn't matter how you do it, but you've got 4 minutes, and if you look at the timer, when it gets to the half, that gives you the you can see that you can, it's time to swap over. I think this is a green one. Okay, so it's time to change over. Okay, so that's it. So if you stop there, I'm just going to just talk about something, because I think that, so actually, no, before I do that, I just want you to think about how do you feel when you talk about that person? If you could call out some of your feelings when you talk. Annoyed, frustrated, sad, yep, disappointed, maybe in yourself as well as the person, yep, sorry, stuck, great, okay. So kind of negative feelings. Okay, so this is what you know. I'm thinking about this a lot, and I think that for me, it's the root of that is in this stuff about the difference between problem focus and solution focus, because I think when you have a problem focus perspective on people, you have this individualized view. Where they are kind of like they are the site of the problem and they are the source of the problem. So you think of them as the place where the change has to take place is within them. So you're viewing them as problematic, you know, because that's the problem focused perspective. Now, I'm not saying that you have these views of people. I really want to make that clear, that you think that they're damaged or that they're flawed or that they're weak. Because I think most people who work for any amount of time with people who are on the edges of emotion or on the edges of behavior and who are disenfranchised, who don't have a place in society maybe, and so on, you do understand how resourceful they are. But I think that when you're using a problem-focused frame, it kind of draws you into that way of thinking. So that they can be seen, that you're looking for what's wrong, or that they're damaged, or that they're weak, you know, and because of that, because you're looking for something to fix, to mend, to make better, your perspective on them is that they need the help and the guidance and protection, obviously, and sometimes people do. I'm not saying people don't need those things, because sometimes the problem focus is the right thing. But also, it's that thing we were talking about earlier about this that we think that there's an ideal person that they should become. that they are far away from that ideal, and you have to help them somehow get there. And then then when your relationship to that person, when you're working in a problem focused room, is you're kind of have that very, very high level of responsibility. That's really stressful. I know. You know, I know what that feels like, how stressful that is to hold that responsibility. You know, you're working with vulnerable people. You have to take you have to be aware of the need for adult protection, child protection, etc. These things are real. I'm not saying they're not, but it's about how thinking about how can that then maybe hinder you from working with them in an empowering way. I think the one great benefit of solution focus is it stops you being so stressed, actually, when you're working with people. I think the people in the room who've done it for a longer time would agree with that, because you kind of don't have to hold all that stuff for them all the time, and it's not 100% your responsibility to make everything better. Doesn't work all the time, you know. But in a solution-focused view, you're thinking differently about people. A solution-focused view, when you work in a solution, you are thinking differently about people. And so basically, you're thinking about them in a much more systemic way. So it's not just them, it's they're in an environment which is affecting them and has an effect on them. You know, maybe if they have a mental health problem, you know, it'd be great if they could get a job and get out, but perhaps, you know, employers are not really happy to employ somebody who has schizophrenia or whatever diagnosis they have, because when they watch TV, you know, they see someone with Jack Nicholas in The Shining, you know, these things are in society, you know, they're not things, people are interactive. Also, people are different who they talk to. I don't know if any of you work with mental health, in mental health. I used to see people who would come in and see me who were very depressed, and they felt terrible, they told me about it, they embodied it. And then I would see them in the supermarket chatting to someone. You know, hi, how are you? You know, and I could think, oh, they're faking it. But that's because actually we are more dynamic than that. We are different in the different, we respond differently. We're dynamic beings. And for example, you're all being very quiet and polite in here. I'm sure you're very polite all the time, actually, but, you know, you're being very kind of well-behaved and quiet, because this is the environment. It pulls that behavior out of you. And if I meet you in the pub later or something, or maybe in the mingle lunch, I love that word. I probably said that the wrong way, but that sounds great. Mingle lunch. You'll be chatting to me and smiling and talking more excitedly. You might be arguing with someone. You know, no, I don't agree with that. No, I think she was terrible. No, I think she was great. Whatever. And you'll be behaving differently because you're in an interacting in a different way. So as an occupational therapist, I'm very interested, obviously, in how people's environment change them. That's something which really, you know, I think this is the idea that we're interactional. There's things that change. So sometimes you can change people by putting them in a different environment. So if you can get them out into a different environment, for example, things change. They experience themselves differently. And this idea, you know, we think of people as being talented and resourceful that will try and find their talents and resources. You had an experience of finding that even within a very unpromising ground of their complaints. And then that people are experts in their own lives. Now, this is tricky because, obviously, if they were such experts, why would they need your help? So I don't mean it like that they're experts in the technology of living, because actually none of us are really that good, if we're honest. You know, we all make mistakes, we all mess up, we all do stupid things, etc. So I think that's different. But I think in terms of understanding how your world works, people do kind of know how that works. And people know stuff. They've lived their life. They're the constant factor in their life. They've lived their life. They know their environments, etc. And so they are an expert in that sense. And I the person who taught me this more than anybody else was a woman who came to see me who was really depressed. She was middle-aged. Actually, she was younger than me now. Probably by about 5 years. Ah, dear. Anyway, she was... See, I've never forgotten that I'm a child. My problem's been the other way, is remembering I'm an adult. anyway, so she was a young woman, and she came to see me. And she was married, and she had two teenage sons, and she was really depressed, because of all of her shattered dreams. You know, she just thought, what am I doing? I'm just a slave to my husband and a slave to my children. Nobody appreciates me. I wanted all these things in my life, and here I am at 55, and I haven't got them, and etc. And she was, really kind of dressed in a very kind of, you know, she hadn't had her hair done for a long time, and she looked really, she was really, really, really depressed. And she just told me this, you know, that she was just like, nobody listened to her husband, never paid any attention to her. She never went, he never took her out. If they went out, he wouldn't dance with her, and et cetera, et cetera. Her teenage boys, they were always up in the rooms playing on their computers, never did, you know, she was just doing all the housework, et cetera. And this is actually quite early on in my solution-focused days, and I wasn't always sure of what I was... I'm not even sure what I do nowadays, but less sure. What do I ask next? You know, what do I do? And I'd been reading a book, and it said, you know, if you don't know what to do, just do something different. So I had no idea what to ask her or what to do. So I just said to her, I said, well, we'll ask. It was before Christmas actually, so there was going to be a bit of a break. I wasn't going to see her for a little bit, so I said to her, basically, why don't you go home and just try and do something different? and anyway, so she came back in, I don't know, four weeks or so. She walked in, and I didn't recognize her. She had she'd had her hair cut, she had makeup on, she was dressed really beautifully. And I was like, wow, what's happened to you? And I said, oh, wow. You know, she said, what's been better? She said, everything. I was like, okay, how did you do that? She said, oh, I just did exactly what you told me to do. So I was thinking, oh my God, what did I say? She said, well, I told her to do something different. And so she said she went back to their house that evening, and it was like 6 o'clock when she was making dinner. She was supposed to be making dinner. And she said there were like clothes all over the floor, and she wanted her children to bring down their dirty clothes or something. And, you know, I don't know the details of it, doesn't really matter. But she was in that place where she was just desperate, feeling like all those feelings of, you know, nobody cares about me, I'm just this slave, you know, etc. And so she thought, I've got to, Rayya said, do something different. So she went into the living room, and she got one of her, maybe a son's CD, heavy metal. And she put it into the CD player, and she started dancing, put it really loud, and she started dancing wildly. And her husband sort of comes down, alarmed, and she won't talk to him. She just carries on dancing. The sons come down, you know, she's dancing. She won't talk to them. She said, I just danced. And she said, around me, she said, the husband made the dinner. The children brought down the washing, put them into the washing machine. Your dinner was ready, and they were like, "Mom, are you going to come and sit down? Are you going to?" She's been to see the psychiatrist in the morning. Obviously, I'm not a psychiatrist, but you know, they—I have no idea. Anyway, everything changed. Everything changed. She said they went out Christmas dinner, dance, husband very attentive, children very loving. Everyone came, sat around the table, talked. They had a big open conversation about what was really going on. So small change, big difference. That taught me a big, big lesson because you know, you talk about evidence-based practice. Well, I don't think that that's something I would recommend to anyone else. You know, just because it worked really well with her, I don't think I'm going to be saying, okay, well, what you need to do is to go home, put on some heavy metal, dance like crazy, and your family will all fall into line. I wish it were that easy. My children just think it's business as usual. Although I usually like Patti Smith rather than heavy metal. But anyway, but that's being an expert in your own life, isn't it? So she knew something. She knew something. I don't even know if she knew what she knew, but she was an expert in her own life. And I've had lots and lots of stories like that. People do things like that where I just could never have made up what the thing was that made their situation shift. So you are who you are right now, and tomorrow you'll be different. So we talked about that, isn't it? We talked about what, you know, you can't be an ideal person, but you know, maybe you can be at your best. So I'm going to get you to create a new description. And what I want you to do, I want you to do, is to re-describe the person you were talking about before the break as someone who's doing their best. I want you to think about what strengths and resources in that person can you identify. Oh, let's go back. I thought I had a timer. Don't worry, I'll time it. So you just talk to each other about the person you were talking about previously, and think about, you know, what if they're doing their best? What strengths and resources can you identify? Okay. Okay, so swap over if give someone else a chance. Okay, I'm going to stop you. Obviously, you can carry on reflecting beyond here. But, you know, what does this new story feel like? How do you feel now? Have your feelings changed in any way? What are you feeling? Tell me. Acceptance. Okay. Is that right, correct? Yeah. What else? Hopeful. Okay. Compassion. Anything else? So, honest. Honest. That's great, isn't it? Wow. Who said that? You did. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Well, I mean, honest, the way I was talking to you, so I see that within
Yeah. Yeah. It's, yeah. Yeah. So I mean, these are really interesting things, because I think, remember, I have a thing, you know, which is that I think solution focus brings you to reality, you know, although it's hopeful and it's, you know, all of these things, but it's about reality, you know. It's like people are really crap sometimes. They're really bad at stuff. They make really bad choices. They have terrible lives, you know. And yet, within that, we're all just human beings trying to do our best. And sometimes we don't know how much better we could be. So I think that for me, that's very much how I started feeling about my clients. It's not that some of them didn't, you know, still get me down. And most of it was sad. And most of the feelings, you know, went from frustration, which is very stressful, to sadness, where I just thought, you know, I'm not sure this person's ever going to get much better than this. Or I think we might have gone as far as we can. Or I wish I could have stopped that person killing himself. You know, I mean, that does happen. So really, it's hard working in these services. It's really, really hard. Anyway, but I still think that it's worth doing, because it's better than having that really hopeless feeling and that you don't know what you can do. This is I like this. It's an illusion. I'm sure many of you have seen it, but it's two people. It's an old woman and a young woman. Can you see them? So the young woman, she's looking away like this, and you can just see her nose and her chin. And then the old woman, she's like, the white is her scarf, and this is her mouth, and she has a big nose. Can you see the difference? It's like that, isn't it? You know, how we see people. Okay, so... again, those of you who maybe have not encountered solution focus before, I'm just going to go through what I think is the basic process. Now, you can play around with this in many different ways. It can be deconstructed and put together. But I think in terms of thinking back to basics, it's the process, the journey that you're taking people on in a solution-focused conversation. You might start in different places, but this is kind of the way you always want to end up. Where you want to end up. So it's just the process. Very, very quickly, I'm going to go through it. So you would traditionally start with establishing the desired outcome, and by asking some kind of question that takes people far into the future beyond their problem. And you would explore that in detail with them. Now, I've called it a preferred future. The classic question is the miracle question, the one we looked at this morning. You go to sleep at night, a miracle happens while you're asleep. You don't know this happened. How would you know when you wake up? Let's talk about the miracle day, and so on. But you don't have to do it that way. You can do it in many different ways. You could do it simply with a scale, which I'm going to show you in a minute. But what you want to do is, whatever you ask, you would be looking for what you would want in the future. It may be as simple as someone says, oh, I don't want to be, you know, shouting at my children all the time and getting into arguments with them. And you just say, well, what would you like your relationship with your child to be instead? That's a preferred future question. So I don't have to use fancy technical questions. You can use something conversational if you wish. There's the really good reasons for using the miracle question when people need miracles. When things are so bad, sometimes the miracle question is just... That's how it started. It started, apparently. These things, maybe they're myths, I don't know. I like this myth anyway. But it started because Insoo Kim Berg was interviewing someone and asking about what would it be like in the future. And the woman said, well, I would need a miracle for that to happen. And she said, okay, let's... imagine that a miracle happened, and that's how myths start. So what you want to do is you want to make sure that the person you found out much more about this. Couple of things. One is that you want to find out what difference it'll make, because as we saw before, actually getting down to meanings is really important. When you were doing the conversations where you were doing before, where you were listening to what matters to people, listening to what people are good at, you were asking how did you do that, the kinds of things that you probably found out were skills, yeah? Skills or qualities, would that be fair? Capabilities, things that they are capable of doing. Whereas when you were listening to the complaining and thinking about the quality, that what was happening, very often what you hear are values, people's values, it should be like this. Or their principles, it should happen like this. People should be organized. People should be fair. So values and principles. That's 7 minutes, by the way, if you have an interview with someone and you ask them, you know, how do you do that? What are you good at? Well, how do you do that? And then listen to their complaints and for 3 minutes. That's 7 minutes. You found out what makes them tick. They found out what they're good at, what they can do, what their values are, and how they like things done. It's quite powerful. Quite powerful. Quick. So similarly, with this, you're listening for what difference will it make, and you're trying to get people to engage with their own meaning. What matters to them? What are their values? Okay, and then also what will be happening, what they'll be doing, what will you be doing differently, what will you be saying differently. So that kind of skill, that action, you're developing your skill building with them. You know, when you're able to be assertive with your boss, what will you be doing differently, how will you be speaking differently. It's a form of skill building. So all of these types of questions have behind them, if you think about it, that you can see what's behind them. They're all subtly different. They bring out different elements. The other thing which is used a lot in solution focus is the use of third-party observations. So the idea if somebody else was going to talk about you. So what would your mother see you doing differently? How would your friends speak differently about you? Those sorts of questions. Because that gives a different perspective. Sometimes people are reluctant to talk about themselves, but they might think about how other people see it. And you can build up rapport. And I mean, I asked somebody who was somebody with a chronic mental health condition who very rarely went out. I said, what would your armchair notice differently about you? Yeah, because he sat in the armchair all the day watching television and smoking. And he said, my armchair would be really lonely. So you can be really creative with these questions. So the idea is you get a really rich description of that future. And then you can, once you've got that, it's kind of like quite far away, over there. So you have to make it more tangible, something that people can hold on to. So I think putting it on a scale is really useful, especially for people whose lives are very chaotic. If there's a lot of chaos, then having a structure, a scale, is really useful. So on a scale of 0 to 10, where 0 is that you are very far away from this preferred future, and 10 is that you have achieved it, where are you now? If you work with people with chronic pain, they always say -1. and then I say, how come it's not 1 at -2? And they say, oh, I didn't know I could go that low. Or they say 0. Sorry, no, I told my story wrong. They always say 0, and I say, how come it's not -1? And they go, I don't know, how come you didn't tell me I could go that low? So, but yeah, so it tells you something about their experiences. So you can that way you can find out what's happening now. So you can ask those, how do you do that? How did you make that happen? You can use those kinds of questions there, and then you can use that listening skill. You can also talk about what happened in the past. If they're, you know, let's say they're at 4, you can say what's happened between 4 and 0, and so on. And then once you've established all of that, you've thought about that, and you've found out where they are, very simply, you would ask them, what's the next step? What do you think the next small step might be? So you would negotiate with them. Where do you think we could move? And that's when you move them into that empirical scientist mode, where they're... Oops, wrong. Okay. So then when you meet them again, if you do meet them again, you can just start really in the same way. What's been better? Tell me what's been better since we last met. And there, what you're trying to do is, even if they say, oh, nothing's been better, you try and find that little thing, the little small chink, even if it's even if there isn't very much there. Again, in my self-help book, I tell the story of one of my clients. I've named her Angela in the book. But when I went to, she was the worst self-harmer in Kent, actually. She actually tried to cut both of her breasts off. That's, you know, that's quite severe. But she was a really beautiful woman. She was a really lovely person. But when I met her, she had been in this. She'd started off her career as an anorexic at 13. Her mental health career as an anorexic at 13, and you know, been force-fed and so on. And then she got a bit better, and she became a nurse and a midwife, actually. But then the self-harming had become obvious, and so she lost her job. She lost her registration. She wasn't allowed to work. And when I met her, she was, I think, in her 40s. So she'd had a 30-year history career as a, you know, mental health patient, and she'd been in therapeutic community. She'd seen many, many different people. And I said to her, you know, well, you know, what, you know, is there? What's the next small step? And she just couldn't imagine anything. I said, well, maybe you could notice just any time when things aren't so bad. She said, it's black. Everything is black. Everything is black. It's just terrible. Everything's black. And I said, okay, well, maybe just notice if there's any chink, if there's anything, you know, just find it for me. And I went away and I thought, oh my God, this is really tricky. How am I ever going to work with this person? And she actually did recover, not fully, but she recovered enough to lead quite a good life until she, very sadly, she died young, but that was because her body had been, she died of natural causes because she had damaged her heart through all the starvation and et cetera. She used to take maybe 30 to 40 paracetamol every day sometimes. Extraordinary. Anyway, she recovered enough to come with me to a Solution Focus conference and present with me. We interviewed each other. And I said to her, you know, what was it like getting Solution Focus therapy? And she said, well, I thought you were mad when you first came to see me and you were asking questions about miracles and whatever. She really did. She said, I thought you were mad, but I liked you. So I thought, well, I'll just go along with it because I like speaking to her. And she said, this very strange thing happened. She said, after 2 weeks, she said, I was in my garden and something I noticed something better. Sorry, I was, because she's died now, so it's a shame. Anyway, she said to me something so beautiful. She said, when I met you, I had like a black, I was like endlessly in the black darkness, she said, and then I just saw this little chink, and it was like the first star in the night sky. And that's what Solution Focus does. You know, she was the most difficult case. But for me, and then she said, and then I started seeing more and more stars, and everything started opening up. So I think for me, that tiny little step, that just the small thing, we talk about in Solution Focus that it generates hope, and I really genuinely think it does. I think it's an incredibly powerful way of working with people. It seems unbelievably simple. You know, what's better is a very simple question, but actually you might have to work very hard to help someone to see that, but it's worth it. It's really, really worth it. Because once someone is on that, you know, when you've got the history of the solution and you're moving towards the solution, the momentum, eventually it will take you there. I think it's lunchtime, don't you? So I think that's enough. You can ask me questions tomorrow. Thank you.